good in new business. Thank you, everybody. I want to call to order our Jenkintown Borough Council meeting for February 2017. Mayor, will you lead us in the pledge?
Absolutely.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Minutes a lot. Can you do a roll call for us, please?
President Bunker?
Here.
Councilman Deppe?
Here.
Councilman Connors?
You notified us this will be late, that's right.
Councilman Barrow?
Present.
Councilman Danlack?
He's not going to make his claim. He notified us.
Councilman Panko?
Same. She's traveling.
Councilman Luger?
Here.
Councilman Golden?
Here.
Councilman McLaughlin?
Present.
Councilman Young?
Present.
Councilman Luger?
Here, sir.
Councilman Solpezia?
Here.
Mr. Vice President, you have a quorum.
Thank you very much. The minutes for the previous two meetings are in Dropbox. I have a motion to approve them. Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Got it. I'll move, ask the council to approve payrolls dated February 2nd and February 16th in the amount of $135,536.78 and invoices totaling $363,626.23. Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Got it. Right, now I'll open the floor for public comment. Yes, please just stand up and say your name and address and then your comments.
My name is Alexandria Cleal at 514 Greenwood Avenue. Governor Thomas Wolf has announced a manufacturing initiative. And I really think, in light of how great Jenkintown is with the public transportation and ready to access to really every corner of this area, we really should try to make Jenkintown a hub. A technology hub, a manufacturing technology hub. I really recommend that the borough reach out to the library. There are some really great websites from the major universities of this country, edx.org, coursera.org. They provide amazing courses, anything from remedial work to IT classes in networking, programming, bioinformatics. You name it, they've got it. In addition, we've got some great community colleges in the area that we should be trying to reach out to. They have associate degrees in automation, in technology. Plus, of course, we have Arcadia and Penn State. We really should be touting how great this area is with our accessibility. And we should try to see how best Jenkintown can be a partner with the governor and to make sure that our citizens of Jenkintown are benefiting from that initiative.
Well, thanks, Senator. That's a terrific idea. And we'll put some thought and conversation in to how to structure and support that. I'll invite you to come back to the Admin and Finance Committee meeting, which is a forum a little better suited to brainstorming ideas like this, if you're willing to help.
I would love to.
Thank you. It's nice to see you. Any other public comment? Okay.
No, right here. Sorry.
Oh, Randy Garvin.
Yes. Randy Garvin, 99 Runnymede. I didn't pick up an agenda. I don't know if there's any plan here to talk about the Cedar Street property. Mm-hmm. But I kind of wanted to bring that up again, and I was at the EAC meeting where that was discussed, a sort of a tentative planning meeting for that, And I don't know, I just kind of wanted to point out some of the, what I think are fallacies in the borough's narrative of the purchase of that and the plans for that. The borough is going around saying that it's going to be a $9,000 per year hit on the, to the school district. That is true, but it's really more of an $11,000 hit because, at least according to Zillow, there's a $11,000, those two properties collect over $11,000 in taxes. And that's a number that's only going to increase because taxes don't go down. The EAC meeting was all well and good, but it was, in my mind, it was an exercise in stake planting. You had a bunch of people there who, well-meaning people who were in trying to envision what this park could be. And what they were shown were pocket parks in New York City, primarily in New York City and in Philadelphia, two areas where they don't have any backyards. The pocket park they showed in Abington, it was an old, it was a parking lot, and they turned that into a park. I'm all in favor of that. But most of all, the big issue that I have with this park, whether it's a good idea or not, is that the public disclosure process for this, for acquiring this park, was just plain awful. It was abysmal. By the strict letter of the law, yes, everything was followed. You place notices in newspapers that pretty much nobody saw, and I have copies of those notices. There, you don't see that. And I have said this several times in the past. It's a very tiny town. It's very easy to get the word out. An email, a Facebook posting, I don't know, easily, they could have notified people that this was going on as it was going on. And the fact that a lot of this was taking place in executive session also seems to me to be a little bit problematic, because I understand that real estate issues do have to be taken care of in executive session. But as I understand it, the property owner came to you and said, here's my property, this is what I will take for it, do you want it or not? There was, doesn't sound to me like there was a lot of negotiating going on. So why this wasn't more of an open process, this was a classic example of which I'm sure many of the people in this room are guilty of. I'm going to do it because if I ask permission, you're going to say no. And because of that, because of the process that went behind this, my position is that the borough should divest itself of this property. It went by getting it in completely the wrong way. And if the only silver lining I can see with this is that if you do go and build a park, which is going to cost, I think, a lot more than a lot of people realize, at least it will justify, at least it will give a borough manager justification for his 24% pay raise. Thank you. That's all I have to say.
Excuse me, Mr. Bunker. Yes. Can I just address some of the legal requirements of purchasing property under the borough code?
If you'd like to. Or we could just move on.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So thanks very much for your comment.
Sure.
We will have a conversation, a report on that EAC park planning meeting between the committee reports and before the engineers report. And your concerns are noted. Any other public comment? All right. Thank you very much. Then I'd like to move on to what is a very happy presentation of something that could have turned out much worse, except for the very courageous actions of a few people who are going to recognize tonight. And I'll turn that over to the chief.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President and Mayor, members of the board, ladies and gentlemen. If I could take a minute to, Juan, want to stand up. Juan was involved in a horrific car accident on February 2nd, around 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and he's here, living and breathing. Thank God, in part of his rescuer that pulled him from his car. And I want to, if you want to say a few words, Ron, then I want to give the commendations to your.
I'd like to ask,
guys, come on.
These two guardian angels to step forward up here with me, you know. In today's day and age that we live in, you know, we often are bystanders, sit around, we watch, we look, we take pictures, we make comments. It really takes a lot of courage, a lot of heart, and a lot of strength to take a step, can cross the line, and put your life in a situation where you're out to touch someone else's life and to save someone else's life. These two gentlemen in front of me have touched my life and my family forever. The courage is in their heart, and the way the Lord has touched them to reach out in a Christian manner and come out and help me when I was in dire straits, to me, really says a lot. I've never seen these guys again. I've never seen these guys in my life. They were put in my life for a reason. Ever since that particular accident that day, I've done nothing but think about these individuals and who these individuals are. And I just want to say thank you. I want to say thank you to both of you. I want to say thank you for stepping forward. I want to say thank you for being there. And I want to say, you know, from the very bottom of my heart as a Christian, I've woken up every morning and I've looked up to the God above and I thank him for whoever you guys are. Now who I know you are, I thank them every morning, and I'll continue to do so for the rest of my life, for every day I take a breath, because I owe my life to both of you. Thank you so much.
Gentlemen in the audience, standing on either side of me are the two very, very brave men. Like Juan said, and by the way, Juan, you don't get one of these. you have your reward because you're here living and breathing. But he wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for these gentlemen. And for that, we want to recognize them for their heroic actions. And your family's going to be right proud of you guys for doing what you did. I can assure you that. Ladies and gentlemen, on Tuesday, February 2nd, 2017, the Jenkintown police were dispatched to a vehicle accident where the vehicle went down an embankment and struck a wall at the Jenkintown train station. The damage from the crash caused the vehicle to be set on fire, trapping the unconscious driver. You showed tremendous bravery and courage by placing yourself in harm's way, rescuing the driver from the burning vehicle, getting him out in a safe distance from the accident scene. Your actions saved the life of a fellow citizen and earned the deepest gratitude from this community and from this police department. Reginald Manley. Christian Riley, thank you so much. And that's all I had. We're very thankful that these guys were there and saved this man's life. And I'm so happy for you and your family, because if it wasn't for these guys, who knows what would have happened, God forbid. But we're thankful for everything you guys did. You don't see that often. People like to take pictures, like Carla said, Juan said, but something they did, they did something new. They jumped right in and did what they had to do for a fellow citizen. Thank you very much, gentlemen. you want to hang around for the whole meeting.
Thank you, everybody who came for the presentations, and don't feel any shyness about leaving. We think it's interesting, but you might not.
Thank you.
Nice meeting you guys.
Nice meeting you.
Nice meeting you, sir. Thanks.
Good job, sir.
All right, gentlemen, see you. Good job. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
It's all good, John, out of your house.
See you guys. See you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Chief. That's very nice of you.
Yeah, it's amazing. I sent the pictures out to you guys. The car was fully engulfed.
Yeah, if they hadn't. To run up to a burning car.
Right.
For a stranger and pull him out before it goes up in flames.
You get up in the morning and you're going to be called on to do that.
I know.
They stepped up.
They sure did. So thanks again. So now to move back into the more quotidian aspects of our council meeting. I'll give the first committee report from Admin and Finance. It's in your folder. It's very exciting reading. There are a number of grants we're applying for. One important thing that Manager Locke was able to negotiate, which I appreciate very much, is a new group to maintain the lights, street lights and stop lights and things like that, moving our rate down from $90 to, is it $60 an hour or $62?
$62.
$62 an hour, down from $90 an hour. So it's quite a nice savings, and we appreciate that very much. Building zoning revitalization. Karen, did you have a report?
Quickly, I'll highlight a couple things from our meeting this past month. One, we presented, we had Sarah Richardson from the Montgomery County Planning Commission come and present her concept design for the gateway welcome sign at the southern end of the borough. And we talked it through quite a bit. We decided to pursue a 2040 implementation grant to help us fund that project. So we're in the process of preparing that. Additionally, we had a relatively long and well-attended zoning hearing board a meeting on Thursday regarding the plans for land development. I'd say there were, and how many folks would you say, maybe 20 residents there for the hearing, close to 11 was completed, and they'll make a decision at next month's hearing on the 23rd. Of particular concern to the residents were the plan called for the demolition of a building at 501 Washington Lane, and residents are concerned about the sound and light barrier that building provides to their homes right on Cedar. Additionally, the Glansman business is seeking relief from a number of greening and setback requirements that we have for parking lots. So, additionally, yes.
There is an opportunity for council, should they choose to do so, to give an advisory opinion to the zoning hearing board, either in favor of or in opposition to.
That's passed.
I was missing.
I'm sorry, I didn't
never
hear
mind.
Her. Oh, I didn't hear what she said about the planning board in Glansman.
So the zoning hearing board, Glansman Subaru is looking for zoning variances to tear down the building at 501 Washington Lane. It's the building up on stilts and make it part of their auto sales lot. And there are concerns that the building serves as a buffer between the houses on the far side of it and the light and noise from 611 from York Road. And then there are conversations about just how much can be done in the way of plantings and permeable surface, etc. All of which are better than what's there now.
Exactly.
I'll
there
say.
Is some improvement to the lot.
But not fully as good as the code requires. So that's going on.
I thought it was a great opportunity for people to come out. The neighborhood was quite well organized with statements, and they did some party status, so they could call witnesses and give testimony. And I think that was a great example of, their citizens of power to do that. So we'll hear what happens with that. And then,
Karen, what are the time frames and next steps with
So the Landsman lawyers need to submit their final legal briefs, I believe, and then the hearing board will present their findings on March 23rd at the next hearing.
Okay, and those are appealable.
They are, and and then the last thing I will highlight is that I, along with Councilor Sipiak, Councilor LeBlanc, and Councilor Panko, attended the EAC's initial visioning workshop regarding the property on Cedar Street. I felt well attended, productive, and constructive workshop. And we're going to the great beginning. I'm sorry, Mayor Foley was there as well.
Sure.
I felt like it was a great initial opportunity for community input on that project. So, Christian, I don't know if you had anything else.
Well, and also that it was for the EAC to kind of give mm-hmm. us their take on green spaces and using the plantings and all, you know, their kind of ideas on the site and the spot. And they obviously have a good handle on that.
Yeah, it was a great brainstorming, mm-hmm. And I was very happy to see so many Cedar Street residents come out.
And how many of the neighbors showed up for the meeting? You said?
Almost all of them. I mean, a lot of them.
Yeah. Most of them had a stake in the development, so they shared their opinions about it, which was great.
Mm-hmm. And there wasn't a singular opinion. There was a diversity of opinions. And there certainly some people who came out who had some particular insights about moving forward the project of this nature. Mm-hmm. And they did, I thought that they did a good job of providing the diversity of examples. So yes, there were some examples from larger cities, but there were some examples from the main line that, you know, may not be completely perfect in terms of their mind of what we have and what we envision, but certainly provided some important things for thought.
Okay. Thank you very much. Councilor Witt?
Yes. Well, let's see, the minutes from the public safety meeting are in the Dropbox. Highlighting the public safety activity for this month, I do believe, is that we received the fire services survey and report. It's quite a lengthy and weighty document. I believe that it's available for everybody. Yes?
Yes, it is.
I myself have started reading it. Maybe a bit more long because I will show it to everybody. It's quite a good-sized document. But basically, one of the things that it does say is that we need to be better at documenting the training we are probably doing.
Mm-hmm.
That's the biggest, if you want to call it a hole. And they actually do have the software and everything to do with it. It's just they're a little bit behind in that. But otherwise, we seem to fit in pretty well with everything. And of course, their long-term push is to consolidate fire. Which they have made right in here, but you know.
I'm not sure I agree with that part. There was the clear call to have the two fire companies cooperate and have the same standard operating guidelines so that when they're at the scene of a fire, they're operating from the same playbook. I don't think it went so far as to call for actual consolidation.
Well, actually, in this document, they do call for it.
Do they?
They do.
All right.
However, I think one thing that we would all agree is it would be nice for us to have a more modern facility for us to go into. Simply mm-hmm. because those are older facilities and all that sort of thing. But I think that's probably going to be a long time after I'm on council. So anyway, that's what we have. I'm happy to answer any questions you may have. And thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right. Public Works, Councilor Connors is not here.
No, I just the minutes, I believe, for Public Works were in Dropbox. I don't have anything to add. I'm sure whatever I could add was addressed in the manager's report in the Public Works report, but I would be happy to answer any questions. I do have one item on the agenda regarding paving.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Jenkintown Community Alliance. President Panko is not here. She's traveling on business.
But I am acting and representative to that role. So I went to the work session on the 13th.
So he said community alliance. You're talking about the school district?
Yes, I am.
Because you accidentally skipped the school district.
You did.
Oh.
So.
Sorry. Well, how about the school district?
Work session on the 13th. There was a good bit of attendance. They voted on the preliminary budget for next year's budget. There's a budget for that. And they also talked about some renovations. They are likely going to seek a waiver of an inspection fee. I think it's normally about $10,000 per ordinance whenever they do kind of significant renovations. So they did discuss wanting to ask the borough to waive that fee. So that will probably come to George's desk before too long.
Thank you very much.
And these renovations are classrooms, media center, teacher lounge. It's significant. The cost totaling estimated $855,000 for this renovation project. So that's
wearing my Ed in finance hat, modifying the fees is probably something we absolutely want to do to support the school district, but there actually are real expenses to do all of the inspections and certifications to so that the school knows that the building is, that the work's done correctly and safely. So we'll have to take a look at that.
Sounds good.
I was just going to say, admin and finance is a good place to discuss that.
Yeah, that's right. So, right, so yeah, there's a way to communicate back that we should come to admin and finance committee with that request. Then we'll help. I just don't know if it could be 100%. But I have to really talk to manager a lot and find out how much of it is work that employees of the borough do and how much we have to pay outside consultants.
Sounds good. I'll pass it along.
Okay. And how JC?
They did not meet this month. They canceled the February meeting, so we have not met.
Councilor Golden, the multi-municipal group.
Sure, just three announcements. There's an education transformation symposium March 3rd. If anyone wants to go, let me know. I'll send out the information. It's in West Philly, and we can get in, we can get in for no charge. Also, on April 18th is the Pennsylvania Association of Community Development Corporation's 25th anniversary. And I could be wrong, that might be the Philadelphia one, but I, yes, Philadelphia Association of Corporate Development, that Community Development Corporations. And that's, that may be useful for people if you want to find out, make contacts about development and that. And third is just an interesting bit of news. The new chief executive officer of William Penn Foundation was on the team that did our revitalization plan. Mm-hmm. And he's a good guy, and he may, I don't know if it'll mean anything, but he is potentially a friend.
Oh, that's great. We'll have to look for grants. Mm-hmm. Someone who knows us to receive your grant. All right, the 2035 comprehensive plan, I don't think there's an update on that right now.
There are some events coming up. Okay. I apologize, I don't have that calendar in front of me. There's an open house coming up. Publicly for the first time the plan and give input. I don't have the date on that though.
The date on that is March
3rd.
I was going to say it's next month.
I apologize.
March
22nd. In the minutes, and maybe we can put it on the upper calendar.
Yeah, I definitely think that would be something we would blast out.
All right, at this point, I was going to ask for a report back about the EAC's meeting about the park, but I think we've already said what we were going to say. Is there any more conversation about that?
We do have a calendar of events the next, going out the next year, calendar year 2017, of public involvement activities. And we'll blast that out via email this week. But that incorporates a couple more visioning meetings, some more community participation meetings around possibilities and brainstorming, and basically it lays out the three-year plan in more detail, 2017, what, you know, this is the year of planning, mm-hmm. next year is the year of funding and implementation, and the following year hopefully we break ground.
That's great. Thank you, Ben. Cal, do you have a report for us? Thank you, report.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. You have my report in the Dropbox. I just would like to offer a couple of additional updates. The first one is for the welcome sign down on Old York Road. We have been working, on the Government County Planning Commission on the revised scope, if you will, which entails all landscaping and some banners and signs. The revisions are progressing nicely. We are working with the Montgomery County Planning Commission on behalf of the borough. The application is due this coming Wednesday. And we help them put together some unit costs that they need for the application, and I have a spreadsheet here that once a submission is made by the Montgomery County Planning Commission, we'll make it available to the borough. The only thing is, I was talking to Natasha this afternoon, also the Planning Commission. Initially, we have put together a couple of easements. One of them is on the basement side, and the second one was on the bank side, so that the borough is able to go in, plant, maintain, and whatever they need to do. My understanding is now it suffices to have Mr. Gansman send something to the borough acknowledging the revisions that were made, and he's okay with the borough moving forward. So it's just something I'm waiting for.
Can I ask a quick question?
Sure.
So those revisions, his accepting of them, is that for sort of the smaller area, the one initial concept, and then the second concept envisioned us actually extending some of the plantings further down on his property? Is he agreeable to that, or?
Well, this is the letter that Professor Lee, the Planning Commission, is looking for. I'm not sure there's a reduction. Actually, I'm on the opposite side where the bank is, there's an extension.
Right, that's where I'm.
Correct.
And he's okay with that? Like,
this is what we're trying to get.
Okay.
Well, I just found this out this afternoon.
Okay.
So
my understanding is yes. Natasha sent him, his counsel, a copy of the draft easement language. It's up to him, but initially their conversations were yes, we'll see what comes out. That's all.
I mean, it would only improve.
Yeah,
it,
sure.
It would be less maintenance for him on his property, and I think it would help us to have a little bit more space to.
And truth is, it's somewhat less impeding on his property.
Sure.
From what was previously proposed.
Yeah.
That's true.
I just want to say thank you to you and to all the people who were involved. I think that the revisions that are taking place to now include improvements to the waiting area for public transportation and the plantings and the van, I just think it's much better and it's much cheaper. And when you see those two things come together, it's really nice. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you. Yeah, it does involve a lot of very small pieces, but at the end of the day, it's going to be a very beautiful, very attractive product. Thank you. So again, this application is due March 1st, and I believe it is on track once we receive your permits of name and everything's good to go.
And I think we'll be voting today to authorize the grant. So
I believe so, yes. And the second quick update is regarding the eight locations of the sewer main rehab that the borough was working on. As of today, seven were completed and only one is not completed. This is the one on Oak between, I believe, Walmart and
Cedar Street between homes.
Yeah, it's on private property. We had mentioned from the get-go that there was not going to be an easy dance, but everything else, the other seven locations were done.
So congrats on getting the seven done. What's the plan to get the one done on private property?
We're gonna sit down and talk to Jordan and see an access standpoint and what details need to be worked out.
If the engineer had recommended videotaping that prior to us going in there,
mm-hmm,
to make sure it hadn't been fixed since our last videotape,
right,
or if it's gotten worse, to know the exact scope of what we need to do,
mm-hmm,
I think that's a great idea. We have money on budget for video, so we're going to take a look at it and see what we're actually doing.
Okay. And then what happens when there's a sewer break on private property? How do we get the access?
Because of health,
you always have
safety,
access.
You always have access.
Under exigent circumstances, in municipality, you can always go on.
It all comes down to what I'm trying to reduce and eliminate as much damage as possible.
And we want to restore it, of course.
The best way in this case is to go, collect the pipe from inside if it is possible. If it truly collapses tremendous, then document the existing conditions, go on fix, and then we have it put back to the way it was.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. There are easements there now. But I have to give credit to the borough manager.
Yes, thank you very much. It's been a busy month for our office, as you see by the agenda. Let me address a couple items which will be on your agenda later tonight. There will be a motion to advertise, I assume, for a medical marijuana ordinance. This is following state law and the fact that we want to, rather than having the use provided for anywhere, we want to limit it to zoning districts, specifically ones that abut 611. And that was kind of the intent going forward, and in mirror the state law concerning all other aspects of that. But we'll have that in place. Number two is, as we know, wireless communications is constantly changing. We have ordinances to better regulate our right-of-ways related to wireless communications, including our ability to put parameters, place zoning restrictions, and place design standards on them. The reason being is that typically the fact that you have cell towers going in is becoming a way of the past. Essentially what people are now doing is putting nodes on telephone poles, things like that. We want to make sure Jenkintown is protected. We all understand that capacity always is increasing and people are using more and more devices. We have to be cooperative in handling that, but we also want to make sure things are not unsightly and regulated in a proper way. And we think this ordinance achieves that. And finally, because I see some folks in the audience, perhaps related to our solid waste collection and disposal award, our office prepared a memo related to that. I'm just going to read it to hopefully preempt any kind of questions that we may get further on, and so then it's kind of all out there in the public one way or the other. The borough solicited bids for solid waste and recycling collection and disposal. These were publicly advertised. A total of four vendors responded to the invitation to bid. The vendors were Advanced Disposal, BFI, Republic, BFI, parentheses, Republic Disposal, Keystone Disposal, and JP Mascara. Also worked with staff in evaluating the bids, and we also held a public meeting inviting all of the bidders, invited all the bidders to review each other's bids, and an opportunity to respond if they had any comments on that. After a review of the bid packages that were submitted to the borough, a legal determination was made that the bids from Advanced Disposal and Keystone Disposal were insufficient. Specifically, Advanced Disposal failed to accurately respond to question one of the bidder's questionnaire. The question posed was, have you or your organization or any partners thereof failed to complete a municipal collection contract or defaulted under any such circumstance? If so, where? Advanced Disposal responded no. However, the borough has received information that both Butler Township and Manalan Township terminated Advanced Disposal municipal contracts in 2014 due to chronic service problems, which Advanced Disposal failed to disclose. Furthermore, Advanced Disposal failed to accurately respond to question 9 of the bidder's questionnaire. Question 9, have you or your organization or any partners or officers thereof been a part of any lawsuits or legal actions where of a civil or criminal nature arriving out of or involving bid contracts or the form performance thereof? If so, given details and disposition of the matter, contrary to the answer, Advanced Disposal has been involved in such litigation, which Advanced Disposal failed to disclose. Finally, Advanced Disposal failed to include in its bid either a Pennsylvania Certificate of Good Standing or a corporate resolution authorizing the submission of bid. Therefore, based on all these factors, that we recommend the bid for Advanced Disposal be rejected. Next, Keystone Disposal failed to notarize the bidder's affidavit, and the vehicle dedication affidavit included in these bids. Per case law, these are fatal flaws, and the borough is not authorized to accept documents submitted in an effort to complete a bid once the bid has been unsealed. Therefore, it's a recommendation of the office that the bid for Keystone Disposal be rejected. After rejecting the bids of the first two vendors noted below, BFI, our current incumbent, is the lowest responsible bidder to the invitation. It is a recommendation of this office, if the borough so chooses, that the 2017 solid waste and recycling collection disposal be awarded to BFI, if that's council's pleasure. Mm-hmm. And that concludes my report.
Thank you, Solicitor Kenny. What is the price of the BFI contract?
Mr. Locke can give you that information.
The price for the 3-year contract is based off 1,400 units. So it's a price not to exceed. And that is $869,779.
Okay, and it's for three Jim Riggins, Public Works Department report.
Public Works report is in your packet and in your Dropbox. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer.
Manager's report, Manager Locke.
Mr. Chairman, my report is also in your packet. A couple things I'd like to highlight, and then I'm available for questions. The LED lighting procurement project, we finally made settlement on that and closed it out, and, well, not closed it out, started it. The installation is expected to start in July. We have a series of lights that we know are out. We didn't know when this construction was going to start, but now we have actual specifications on the lights. We're going to go purchase 8 or 10 of those, replace the ones that are out, and then the entire lighting system will be changed out in July. Aqua is doing some major water main work on the outskirts of town, Washington Lane between York and Greenwood, and Township Line between Summit and Washington Lane. Township Line is a state road, but there was a detour set up for that, and that's been made available online and in the blast. PICO is proceeding with their gas main project. They've completed Cloverly, they're moving to Hillside, and they're still on schedule to finish Robin at early August, so that we could pay with the 17th, probably it's good. The only other thing I had that I wanted to mention was there is going to be something that comes up under new business, because it came in an hour before the meeting from Addington Township. They are also filing for the 2040 implementation grant for work on Washington Lane in front of Friends School down to Autumn Lane in their township, and they're just asking that Borough Council support the project.
Thanks very much. We'll talk about that during the new business discussion, but it's to put a sidewalk in along Washington Way in front of the school. So I'm optimistic.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
George, do you have any indication what the latest is on the Noble Bridge reconstruction? That seems to be pretty far behind previously communicated schedules.
They were talking about starting at 17. I know they had, did you attend the utility meeting, or was that the traffic?
No, it was either Offer or Wilmot, but I believe it is. It's spring. Is it spring or
the meeting?
They
had a meeting last Thursday on utility coordination.
Uh-huh.
But I was told that it was mid-17 is when they're actually going to start construction.
Okay.
So but I don't have a date.
Okay. And Chamonix Creek got pushed back a little bit, I understand. Is that anything you can talk about? The Chamonix Creek Brewing Company and the Guild Hall business?
Don't play dumb, George. I know you're not.
Important news.
I'm not aware of it being pushed back.
Okay.
The dates that I heard are still.
Okay.
Awesome.
Getting some beer back in that building. Very important to this community.
Bring back that manufacturing.
That's it.
That's what that is.
Beer manufacturing. And then the dental implant business, the dental device is the only like, true sort of manufacturing of things that I know of in the borough.
And
I don't think there's anything else. There's plenty of businesses like computer software businesses and things. Anyhow, let's move into the order of business. Councilor Connor.
I make a motion to approve the addition of Shoemaker Avenue between Cedar Street and Needham Street as an alternate road on the 2017 paving project.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Yeah. Councilor Farrell.
I make a motion to advertise ordinance number 2017-1 pertaining to the Medical Marijuana Act.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Second.
For discussion, just to clarify, this is the zoning to make sure if a dispensary comes into town, it's basically in the commercial or center of town areas on York Road.
It's the neighborhood commercial residential and zone district that we set it as.
All right. Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? That's unanimously supported. Then, Wireless Communication Commission to advertise.
referenced, I make a motion to advertise ordinance number 2017-2 pertaining to wireless communications facilities.
Second.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? All right. Passes unanimous. I'm next. This is a grant to get the money for the welcome areas of the southern end of Washington. So I make a motion to approve resolution 2017-4, authorizing the application to the Montco 2040 implementation grant and commitment of matching funds not to exceed $20,000.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Release of escrow. So this is for the construction of the new Lansman facility that was where the sink station used to be. I make a motion to approve the escrow release number one in the amount of $262,610.85 to OYR Holdings Limited Partners. This escrow is for 90% of the funds, as the developer still has four outstanding items per Penelope Associates' recommendation to release that.
Second.
Discussion?
It's Exxon.
Was it Exxon? Sorry. It's neither anymore. Any other discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous. And then this is to award that solid waste collection contract. Thank you very much for being thorough, Sean, you and your office. I have to say, it's such a disappointment just missing the notarization.
It is, but it's case law.
I understand there's no gray area. It's just still disappointing. anyway, I make a motion to issue a notice of intent to award the solid waste contract to BFI in the amount of $169,779 for once per week curbside collection and disposal of municipal waste and recycling for a period of 3 years, effective 1 month.
Second.
Any discussion?
I don't think it's notice of intent to award. I think this is actual awarding contract. This is the awarding the contract, just
okay.
To be clear. Yeah.
So it's not notice of intent to award, it's the award.
Yep.
So with that change, is there a second?
Second.
And any discussion?
It was discussed before. This cost will change the taxpayers' cost for their pickup, their quarterly. Doesn't really change it, right?
It will change. This is an increase of 4.5%. It won't change it for this year.
Right.
Because we budgeted the increase. We allowed for a 10% increase, and the increase is only 4.5%.
Okay.
The 4.5% isn't per year, but that's over the 3 years.
Okay.
So it doesn't actually look like the fees are likely to be pushed up by this contract.
No, I think that they will need to be increased after this year.
Okay. Well, we'll discuss that in more detail. I have an appointment
as a finance. Yeah. We're still hammering out the exact dollars.
Okay.
One of the things we did 1,400 units as a price not to exceed, because we didn't know exactly how many we had it. After it's paid out, turns out we're exactly 1,300 units. So the $869,000 contract will actually be $807,000 contract when it's hammered out.
Let's take a careful look at it in Avenue Finance, because I'd like to keep the fees flat if we can.
I just want to make sure I understand that this is now going to go to Admin and Finance to determine the years and which option.
This contract is now, when we vote on this, this contract is going to be awarded.
The fees
that we charge residents for waste disposal.
Yeah, how do we fill in the blanks on this then? Which of the awards is
what BFI submitted, which is what I gave them out.
Yeah, there are four different submissions.
No, BFI was the only lowest responsible bidder.
There were four different scenarios.
We were awarding the base bid.
So you have a share before this one. So all in favor of this?
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, we've got this done. Now, what we'll discuss at Admin and Finance is what this new pricing compared to the actual number of units means in terms of the bill for solid waste. You can't change this year, I mean, that's right. Yeah. But in the out years, to figure out what we want to do. All right? Then we come to the letter of support for Abington. So Abington wants to put sidewalk across the street from our solicitor's house.
No comment.
But on the other side of the road, along Washington Lane, on the side of the school, which I think is positive for safety. It also will give them an opportunity to do some improvements to that intersection, the really problematic drainage intersection of Greenwood and Washington Lane, and maybe take a stab at that, although I suspect more needs to be done than just this.
But we don't know yet if that's a part of what they plan to tackle. We just know they're going to do the sidewalk.
No, George said that they will actually. Would you speak up for it?
Yes, I will speak to it. The plans that they sent me starts with curb close to Greenwood. There's already about 50 feet of curb. There's 100 feet of curb coming from Greenwood. They're going to tie into that and extend that down past Vernon to where we have their first entrance. Then it'll become sidewalk and curb, and it'll go all the way to Harbor. So in front of New Bowl, there will be sidewalk on the opposite side. And when we were discussing with Vice President Bunker, I said the curb down near Greenwood will assist with the drainage of water coming off Byron.
Just the curb, just that curb.
And headed to that, yeah, they're just going to install curb between midpoint between New Bowl and Vernon to Greenwood. But we are in discussions with improving that intersection. Abington's in discussions with friends, and they've had positive reactions and wanting to improve that intersection and the drainage, and they want to do that in conjunction with us since we own three fourths of the intersection.
So what I'd like to propose, what I make a motion to have happen is that we ask George to write a letter of support for this project to Abington. They'll use in their the application for the bid for Montgomery County application.
Second.
Any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Right. George, quick question. I think Marley had talked about when we were discussing our implementation grant for the Gateway, partnering with Cheltenham and Abington, asking them for letters of support for our grant. Have we done that, to your knowledge? I know we had a tight turnaround.
Yeah, I haven't done it. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's been done. I know there's a few different parties working on it. We have a reason for them to write for us.
That's what I was thinking. yeah, I was working on groups within the borough to support it, but I was not reaching outside of
tomorrow.
First reading is always appreciated. Any other new business? Okay. All right. Do we have any need for an executive session? We do. This is about real estate.
Real estate and litigation.
Okay. So I move that we adjourn the general session. We will go into executive session, and then we'll come back into general session to
recess.
Sorry. All in favor?